What's up, beautiful people? Today we're going to be checking out another amazing interview by Vivek Ramaswamy and Tucker Carlson. This one is Vivek on US giving Saudi Arabia nuclear power. I'm sure you guys have heard the speculations like I have, so it's going to be an interesting one. Let's get to it.
Now, I think there are some broader regional issues that we need to deal with too. I mean, one of the lurking issues here is the nuclear capabilities of Iran. And if I had the clear answers, if any of us had the clear answers to exactly how you would keep Iran from becoming nuclear weapon equipped, you know, we wouldn't be talking about this right now. But I think a maximum pressure campaign against Iran, economically speaking, until they actually fully phase out their nuclear weapons is a reasonable discussion and debate to have.
Well, I think the best way to keep anybody from having a nuclear weapon is for you yourself to not have a nuclear weapon. That's how it's going to work. Otherwise, what are you going to tell Iran if you have a nuclear weapon? You're asking them not to have a nuclear weapon. It's kind of like, hold up, are you holier than me? I mean, that's the question I would ask. So the best way to keep anybody from not having a nuclear weapon is to lead by example. Just saying.
I think we can avoid doing some really stupid things that we've done along the way, though. In the meantime, this year, think about the discussion around transferring nuclear technology to Saudi Arabia.
Now, why would you ever want, and Saudi Arabia, which got some of the deepest energy reserves in the world, clearly need nuclear plants. So that technology would be used for nuclear weapons. Why would you ever want the Saudi Kingdom to have nuclear weapons?
Well, it's even one step worse than that, right? We've done civilian nuclear technology transfers. I think we've done like something like 27 deals with 43 countries.
Yes.
Saudi Arabia did not want the terms of those traditional civilian nuclear technology transfers because they require oversight and monitoring to make sure you're not using it for military purposes. So the idiocy of this, and it's not just Biden. I mean, Biden's idiocy is high. But there's Republicans going along with him to say that as a condition for getting Saudi Arabia into some type of expanded diplomatic deal with Israel, we were going to offer security guarantees to Saudi Arabia.
Honestly, this is beginning to feel like an anti-American agenda because a lot of push, everything has been going, it's been happening outside of America. You see the nuclear or green energy thing, where it's like we're not digging fossil fuels, rather would give, you know, a different nation the entire power of building EVs. And the same thing here too, they're sending power outside of America. Anyways, let me know what you think about that.
And furthermore, that we were going to offer this nuclear transfer on terms that were different than the historical civilian.
So the idea is to counterbalance Iran, I assume.
But actually, if you look at it the other way, we've had I'm not saying it's a comfortable balance of power, but there has been something resembling a balance of power. This is this summer we're talking about, Tucker, and this is an uncomfortable topic, but we can't just dismiss the possibility that these two things are entirely unrelated. I mean, right when we have inserted our noses in to this, what I think is a terrible idea to deal with Saudi Arabia, and I think many in Israel otherwise agreed with me too, that transferring nuclear technology to Saudi Arabia on these differential terms and security guarantees, that shouldn't be necessarily what's required to drive Saudi Arabia into a peaceful deal with Israel. In some ways, we're the ones that just stuck our noses and tipped the scales in that balance of power if that Saudi Arabian deal were going to proceed. And then when you get 2 months later, this disastrous attack. So I think that there are complicated factors at work here that weaken our own goals that we have scored in this process off the table. And then all of those savings from a war that we would have avoided, you know what Israel and U.S. can use it for? Protecting our own respective borders. I mean, that was a border crisis of historic
proportion.
Did you guys see the budgets for the border and the one allocated for Israel and Ukraine? It was pretty interesting to me. I had seen it. I don't want to speculate because I've forgotten the numbers, but I'll put it on the screen if I can find it again.
National defense bill.
I agree completely.
And if it can happen in Israel, it can happen here too, by the way.
It is.
On the regular.
Yes. So, but just to back up for one click, the idea that we would in any way abet a nuclear program in any country, particularly in Saudi Arabia, is so destabilizing and crazy. It suggests that people have lost their awe of their fear of nuclear weapons. I'm watching people on television or the internet sort of blithely talk about the possibility of the use of nuclear weapons in this conflict. I watched it 5 times yesterday. Can we agree that anyone who sort of throws out, maybe they'll use nukes, is insane? You'd have to be a mental patient to say something.
I mean, either that or so profoundly ill-informed about what the consequences would be for the United States. And so I really can't speak for the mental state.
But it could also be because words are so diluted these days. People use words like racism, diversity, equity, people just throw those words around. That's how nuclear weapons or nukes are being thrown around. So words don't have strong meanings anymore because people use them so much. It could also be that. And even death. The other time somebody said in a video I'd seen that three people died, and it was so easy. I think they said only three people or just three people died, something like that. It just felt like just three people died compared to the number of people that should have died or could have died, just three died. That is still three people. So we're taking these words to mean or to be very normal. I feel like that's it. It's not necessarily, it could even have a lot more to do with the media. Not necessarily the people themselves, but the media they ingest.
Of some of these people, Tucker, who are viewing the expansion and nuclear proliferation to Saudi Arabia, the consequences.
People are saying, oh, this could go nuclear. If pushed, we'll go nuclear. They'll go nuclear. Go nuclear.
Yeah. Think about the consequences.
Millions died. And the consequences of it are impossible to foresee, but we can guess.
Yeah. So this is what frustrates me about where we are in this. And, you know, the views I'm adopting here, I think from a political perspective, a lot of people have advised me, this isn't really where you want to go. I think somebody has to step up and actually ask the questions that other people are too afraid to ask. What are the consequences of the biggest thing that's about to happen? If Israel mounts that ground war in Gaza, appears to be the next step in this conflict, and there's no clearly identified objective, what are the consequences for Israel? We ask that as a friend. What are the consequences for the United States? We should ask as Americans. And I think there's a better way. There may be multiple better ways to do this, but we're not going to get there unless we have actual unfettered debate on the merits. And I think there's something, particularly in the Republican Party, actually, around the culture of this issue that has really stifled that debate. The experience I've had, the first time you and I met was, I don't know if you remember this, was after I was writing my first book. It was in the context of I'd been a biotech CEO and George Floyd died, and this country started acting crazy, and there were certain debates you couldn't have on questions relating to race and whatever back in 2020. I remember what that felt like. It was a speech suppressive environment where there were certain debates you weren't allowed to have. And many on the left would call me racist as a way of
silencing. See what I just said, the word diluted.
Open debate and believing in colorblind meritocracy. It feels really similar. It feels really similar in a different way right now, where isolationist has become the new racist, a new label to use as a substitute.
Saying you hate Israel.
Yeah, exactly, or whatever. You can fill in the blank for whatever the silencing label would be. Pro-Mas, ridiculous. Anti-Israel, ridiculous. But to use that to silence debate on the merits, and whether that comes from the left or right, it doesn't much matter. That's, I think, the ultimate form of anti-Americanism.
And this is going to be challenging for the future. If you can't even have discussions or talks or even debates about situations like this because somebody's going to tag you to be anti something or pro the other. No, I just want to talk about it. At least hear me out first before you tag me. So this point he just made, I think, is very vital, very, very vital, especially in America. It's in Canada as well, but especially in America.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say, your attack for asking what's good for the United States and asking that as an American who's trying to lead the country, if that's considered out of bounds, if you're being denounced by Republicans for saying that, then the whole America First thing was just a lie.
Yeah, I think that I think it wasn't a lie when it comes to the people of this country. I think the leadership, though, would like to believe it was a lie, like to believe that it was a passing phase, an attachment to one man, where this is a broader vision that goes beyond.
Well, it's just common sense that you live here and you've got children.
Put this country first.
Well, that's your job.
Yeah, it's a moral obligation.
It's a little weird that people are picking sides and the Capitol got invaded by these lunatics, pro-Hamas lunatics, and then people are taking the pro-Israel side. But I don't know, anybody say, I have views on all this and I like Israel better than Hamas, but ultimately I'm for America. Why? That seems like the natural position for Americans to take.
I think it's the more trustworthy position for Americans to take. Not only with people at home, that's the moral obligation of an American leader. It's also more credible. I mean, if you're one of America's friends abroad and you say that I irrespectively and unconditionally stand with you regardless of my national interest, even if I'm sitting as somebody in Israel listening to an American say that, that's not credible. That's obviously fake.
We said that to Ukraine.
Yeah, we said that.
Don't believe us when we say that.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. And our adversaries can draw clearer red lines when we're just honest about the fact that U.S. leaders should act in the U.S. national interest. And the fact that that's become controversial, I think, shows how far our mistaken foreign policy establishment has come. But there's a better way to do this.
It could also be that the U.S. leaders are acting to the believed or perceived interests of the American people. But again, that interest seems to be divided everywhere between the conservative views and the liberal views and all of those things. I remember making a video on the other, I think it was about Russia and Ukraine when it first started. Then I spoke about neutrality and people having to dialogue and settle it diplomatically. I got lots of comments where people were like, the blood of Ukrainians are in your hands. I'm like, no, I'm not saying this should happen. I'm just saying, listen, read the mix too. These are the documents I've read. Did you check this out? That's what I was trying to outline. I ended up taking down that video because people didn't want to hear me. I thought if I'm making the videos for you and you don't want to watch it, why leave it there? So I just took it down. I even got like comments on Instagram and all of those things, but I'm not even going to go into that. But my point is, at least have a debate for both sides. At least try to listen to the other person, you know, hear them out and talk about it. If you're saying this is something about Israel, it doesn't mean you're anti-Hamas. If you're saying this is something about Hamas, it doesn't mean you're, and what is the word, anti-Israel? It's just a discussion first. But more and more we see those discussion channels being closed, and it's a problem. The fact that there's so much division right now in the world and even inside nations is very troubling. Anyways, that was a beautiful interview, Vivek Ramaswamy and Tucker Carlson. If there's anything you want to add, correct, critique, please feel free to do so. That being said, smash the like button, subscribe, and I'll see you on the next one. Peace.